Welcome to the Atheist in Recovery podcast, where we talk about finding hope in recovery. And now your host, Dr. Adina Silvestri.
Hello, guys, and welcome to episode 49 of the Atheists in Recovery podcast. And today's episode is veering off of our normal episodes in that we are talking about sugar addiction. And so whether you are new to emotional eating or binge eating is something that you're quite familiar with, or maybe you've replaced alcohol addiction with sugar addiction, irregardless, I think a lot of us are struggling with this, with having all of this food around and being physically isolated at this time of COVID-19. And so I thought today we would talk about sugar addiction and how to overcome it. And so we have today our guest, Jonathan Cranford, and he wrote a book. And the book is called Sugar Demons. And the book is interesting in that he takes the psychology of gaming and he utilizes that to build a program on how to kill, his words, kill your sugar demons. So that's just a little snippet. On to our guest, Jonathan Cranford. Jonathan is a level 2 CrossFit trainer and a former USA boxing coach. Like many great authors of past generations, Jonathan is also a raging addict. His recent book, The Sugar Demons, An Addict's Guide to Conquering Sugar Addiction, dives into his up and down struggle with the white substance that holds most of us in its grips. So true. With 20 years of experience in health and fitness, he decided it was time to finally break his addiction to face the consequences. Jonathan lives in Houston with his wife and two rescue dogs. All right, guys, on to the show. Jonathan Cranford, welcome to the show.
Thank you for having me.
So I am excited to have you on the show today because we are talking about sugar addiction and your book, The Sugar Demons. But before we get to the book, I want to start our conversation by asking about your spiritual background from childhood.
Ooh, okay. So I am currently, I guess, what you would call agnostic. Like, I don't really believe in any organized religion that's out there. I think that, you know, they all can't be right and they're probably all wrong to some degree. But I got there starting out as a Catholic. I remember going to Catholic school from first to third grade, and that's how we started. And you'd think that making the jump from Catholic to agnostic would be pretty easy because, you know, a lot of Catholics only go to church like twice a year. Everything's in Latin, so you can just kind of stop showing up. But that's not what happened. And around third grade, for some reason, my parents became, or we converted sort of to a Southern Baptist church. Mm-hmm. And I, to this day, I don't know why, and I haven't asked them, and I probably won't because I don't really care. But it was like this very angry form of Christianity, as I recall. I was really young, but I remember the pastor getting like yelling a lot and getting like really red in the face. Like he would be like screaming so loud and, you know, talking to us about sin and hell. And it was like fear, very fear-based also. Like, you know, if you didn't, you know, live a certain way or believe a certain way and, you know, get saved, then, you know, you were going to burn for all eternity. And that was probably the beginning of the end for me when I started really questioning, you know, all of this stuff and, you know, what it meant to be a Christian and all of that. So that went on for a while. And then around high school, I think I just started, I realized, you know, after trying, and I really did try, you know, after trying for a while to believe in all of this stuff and to go along with it, I eventually just was like, okay, I really don't. And so I stopped doing all of that stuff. But I don't have any issues with it. My, you know, it's very positive and beneficial in a lot of people's lives. I think my own daughter is a Christian now. She and her boyfriend practice a very positive version, it seems, to me, of Christianity. So I'm fine with it. It's just, you know, the experience I had, it just wasn't for me. So I left it, and I don't plan on going back ever again.
Yeah. So it doesn't sound like you had a great experience with organized religion. So how did that impact your recovery? So maybe now just sort of talking about your recovery journey, I think might be helpful for the listeners.
Yeah, absolutely. So I have been an exercise enthusiast, if you will, for a long time. I played some sports growing up and I did some personal training and also now I'm a coach at a fitness facility as part-time. It's not my real job. I'm a school teacher, a public school teacher, but I do coach people in health and fitness, and I help them with their diets. It's just kind of a side hustle, if you will, but it's just some really more of a hobby that I enjoy doing. And I've been doing that for a long, long time now, you know, since I was in my early 20s. But that entire time, I was also struggling with sugar addiction, even though I really didn't know it. And I really didn't realize it until I was about 37 years old. And that's when it sort of all came together for me, that I had a problem, which is, you know, sad, because I'm, you know, I guess I'm just very slow at, you know, self-realization or having epiphanies or whatever. But I was 37, and I remember, you know, that old worn out movie trope or literature trope where, you know, we sort of symbolize somebody's addiction by, you know, showing them in a scene where they're like passed out behind a dumpster or a garbage.
Right.
Something. Yeah. There's some sort of trash receptacle involved usually that just shows that, oh, this person's hit rock bottom. Like this is they're addicted to something, you know, it's alcohol, drugs or something, and their life is in the gutter, whatever, you know, and my life wasn't at that point, but I was staring into a trash can when I had my little epiphany, and it was my kitchen trash can. And the reason I was staring into it is because I had just finished eating 2 pints of ice cream, which is sort of my go-to, my trigger food. And I was trying to hide them by putting them into the trash can and then covering them up with garbage that was already in the trash can. So that my family, my wife and daughter, wouldn't see that I had eaten 2 pints of ice cream, not just one. And I realized that I was doing that because I was ashamed.
Yeah.
And that's when I realized, okay, this isn't normal. Like my wife and my daughter don't really care how much ice cream I eat. They don't even really understand that I have a problem. I didn't really understand that I had a problem at this point. They were just like, oh yeah, dad eats a lot of ice cream. And he's not really willing to share it, which is weird. But otherwise, you know, I wasn't really sick or obese or anything like that. I kept in as best shape I could. Mm-hmm. But, I struggled with diet and, you know, it was hard for me. So I realized staring into that trash can, I was like, oh, this shouldn't be this hard, especially with somebody with the knowledge and background that I have. Mm-hmm. You know, why is this so hard? That's the question we need to ask ourselves. Why is it hard to stick to a healthy diet? You know, so I realized staring into that trash can, I was like, oh, I'm hiding this because I'm ashamed. And I'm ashamed because this isn't normal. And so this is a problem. And that's when I started to really understand like, oh, this is actually an addiction. That's why it's hard. That's why I'm not making logical choices when it comes to food. That's why I ate 2 pints instead of one. And I said I was only going to eat one and save the other one for later. So that's when I really understood like, okay, I have an issue now. And that's when the recovery actually began, because that's when I realized, you know, oh, this is something I need to fight against.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And so how did that journey start for you? So once you acknowledged that you had a problem, what next?
Right. Well, I was really lucky at the time because I happened to be reading, I happened to have come across this book by an author named Jane McGonigal. She has a TED Talk. So somebody go, you know, check her out, or you can put the link in the show notes. Or
something. Yeah. Yeah.
But she's amazing. And she wrote this book called Super Better. And in Super Better, the reason she wrote it was because she had had a concussion and she had post-concussion syndrome, which basically means they put you on something called brain rest, where you can't do anything hardly. Like you can't really watch TV for very long. You can't read. You basically just stay in your room and don't get too much mental stimulus because it's just, you know, it's interrupting your healing. And so you stare at a wall. If you're lucky, you know, you look outside for, you know, a couple of minutes a day, and it's very depressing. Her injury wasn't getting better. So she was getting very depressed, and she basically was like, okay, I'm either going to kill myself or I'm going to find a way out of this. She also happens to be, I think she has a PhD in the psychology of video gaming or the psychology of games.
Interesting.
Right. So she's written a couple of video games herself. She's created some things. And so she was like, I'm going to game my way out of this. So she developed this sort of video game-like structure called Super Better. And it's amazing. And I read it, and it was very inspiring to me. And so I was like, you know what, I can recover. I can do this. And so that was one of the things that helped to inspire me. And I had to come up with my own system. Mm-hmm. But her system is definitely part of, you know, how I control my recovery.
Mm.
But that was the inspiration that started it. And, you know, I was also writing and reading a lot of, you know, what other people were doing. And I just kind of came up with this system on my own that works.
So it's almost like instead of going the traditional route, like 12 steps or something like that, you decided to sort of write your own Bible, if you will, on how to recover.
Yeah, I did. And that was part of the recovery process. It was great for me to share it. And it was amazing to get so much good feedback on it. And it was, you know, and it is a bestseller to this day. But before I even wrote the book, I was writing blog posts about this journey. And I got a lot of feedback on that, you know, on some of them, which is what sort of inspired the book.
Okay.
But yeah, my system is not 12 steps. It's about 3 or 4. Really, depending on how you attack it. But the 3 basic steps that'll get you, you know, 80 to 90% of the way there is the most important, number one. Mm-hmm. And I haven't seen this in a lot of other, even, you know, people who have written other books that, you know, on addiction or recovery. But this one really works for sugar. And that is, you need to track your cravings.
Mm.
Because your cravings are not random. Like you think they are. They're not just happening to you. Like, they're actually very predictable for the most part. For me, it was always right after I got home from work. So around 2:30 PM, mm-hmm. I was teaching high school at the time. So, you know, we had a high school schedule. They get out earlier in where I live. And so I would get home about 2:30 PM. And, you know, after a stressful day, and that's when my first big trigger would be, you know, mm-hmm. like I'm having had a stressful day, I get home, automatically I want something to make me feel a little bit better. And then my second craving of the day would usually be right after dinner. So around, mm-hmm. you know, 8:30, 9 PM. So, and it's usually, I guess, that I would trace the trigger back to, you know, maybe stressing about tomorrow, you know, something that has to get done tomorrow or else, that kind of feeling, which we all experience. So a lot of people right now, just from hearing that, are like, oh yeah, you know, you can just track your cravings. Some of you can do it just without even having to write anything down, or you just do it in your head. You're like, oh yeah, that's me. So, you know, for me, it was right after work, right after dinner. And then on weekends, it changes a little bit. You know, you have to track those also to kind of, you know, figure out your weekend schedule. Anytime your schedule changes, you know, your cravings are going to change a little bit too.
How would you recommend tracking your cravings? Because I feel like the average person is going to forget a lot of what's happened throughout the day if they don't somehow write it down or track it.
Well, that's the number one thing. Yeah, write it down.
Yeah, yeah.
You need to keep a spreadsheet. If you're a spreadsheet person, you know, that's a mm-hmm. great way. Just make a little spreadsheet real quick. And then, you know, if the first week of your recovery, you know, is just tracking your cravings, not even fighting necessarily or trying to, you know, avoid succumbing to your cravings, but just writing it down. So if you, you know, had a bad moment and you, you know, ended up eating an entire package of Oreo cookies, which I've done many a time, mm-hmm. then just write it down. It's okay, you know, but mm-hmm. keep track of that. And you will see a pattern. Eventually, it will not take more than a few days.
Okay.
So yeah, so write it down, make a spreadsheet, however you want to track it is fine. And then, you know, from there, you know, your step two is you need now a plan and replacement foods, because you can see the cravings coming now, right?
Mm-hmm.
So before you had cravings, before you tracked your cravings, it was very binary. You were either in the middle of a craving and you were in that seeking mode, or you were not in a craving anymore. And, or you were just either in or out of the craving, and that was it.
Mm-hmm.
And now you have a before. Now you've got a 3-part thing. You've got before the craving, during the craving, and after. And mm-hmm. a lot of the before stuff, you can kind of head off those cravings, which is really powerful.
Mm.
But you do that by having your replacement foods ready, and you do that by, you know, which are healthy foods, you know, foods, and I list them in my book. You know, there's a long list of, you know, what is sugar, what is, I break it down into, you know, here's a green light foods, yellow light foods, and red light foods.
Mm-hmm.
We can get into that later, but, you know, have your replacement foods ready, have a plan. So with mm-hmm. Super Better, she talked a lot about having like a boost, you having, giving yourself a power up, they call it. And so that's part of my, you know, having a plan is, you know, before the craving even starts, maybe give yourself, you know, take a supplement or do something that boosts you emotionally, gives you a positive feeling, like listen to a powerful song that you love,
or,
you know, something, you know, it can be a physical thing, do 10 push-ups, drink a glass of water, you know, take a supplement, anything that just gives you a mental boost going into it. And then you go, okay, well, this is, now I did that. I feel ready to take this on. I know the craving's coming. Now I'm going to eat a healthy meal so that when the craving strikes, I'm already eating something, or, you know, I'm about to eat something, whatever, that's healthy and better for me. And after you eat something, you're typically not going to, you're pretty much through the craving at that point. Usually if you need to do something else, you find that's not working, then, you know, you need to have another part of that plan that, you know, gives you even more resilience. You know, if you have to go brush your teeth right after, or, you know, stand on your head, whatever it is you have to do, you'll figure it out. But just having a plan gives you a lot of power and resiliency. So the other part of that is number three is control your food environment. And this actually is also really, you know, it kind of goes back to what I said, you know, have replacement foods ready. You can't really have replacement foods ready if you're not controlling your food environment. And what I mean by controlling your food environment is this. Your food environment is the landscape of food choices that you have around you at any given time. So if I'm at work and I didn't bring my lunch, then I've got to hurry up and find food within like a 45-minute window or something like that, depending on what your lunch break is. And your options, my options around where I work are pretty terrible. It's a lot of fast food. There's a few places that you could get something healthy, but you know, you also have to realize that you're part of, you're, you know, you're human and you're always going to follow the path of least resistance. So my program takes willpower and discipline and all that out of the equation because I don't really, I don't rely on it. Willpower doesn't work.
Agreed.
You know, so you have to really head it off by controlling your food environment. So what I do instead is I meal prep once a week and I try to keep it as brief as possible because I know people get scared when they hear the word meal prep, like, oh my God, I have to cook, you know, it's so hard, but it doesn't have to be. It's really easy. You don't have to be that elaborate with it. You can be if you want to, but you don't have to. So I carry a lunchbox most places, you know, if I know I'm going to be eating at some point and, you know, while I'm out of the house and, you know, I have already prepped healthy food with me. So if I'm at work and I have my lunchbox, like it's the path of least resistance is, you know, just go into the lunchbox and eat your food.
Yeah.
Actually, it takes more work to go off away from your job and go get something than it does just to heat up in the microwave, which you already have. So meal prep is part of it, but it doesn't have to scare you off. It, you know, you can do it. And I can show you how to do your entire meal prep in 1 hour. That's one of the main parts of the book is like, get everything done in an hour. If you want to be more elaborate and do something, you know, a little bit more fancy or whatever, then you can take more time if you choose to, but try to make it as simple and basic and easy as possible. And then, you know, the way you control your food environment at home is you just don't have sugar and processed foods in your home, which a lot of people, you know, that's like the first step for a lot of people, just get all that stuff out of the house. So the meal prep is the one that's usually the biggest hump for people to get over. But I will say this, and I think I say it in the book, that anybody who tells you different, that you can get through this, you know, using willpower and without having to do some sort of prep or cooking, is usually that's somebody trying to make money off of you or sell you a fad that isn't going to work. I'm going to be honest with you and say, if you don't do the work, you know, if you don't put in, if you don't cook a little bit once a week, even if it's just an hour to get that, you know, meal prep done, then you are going to succumb to your environment at some point. And that's a fail. And, you know, we want to minimize those as much as possible.
Yeah. So I like that. So step one is track your cravings. And you recommend getting a spreadsheet or just some way to track it. I'm sure there's an app. There are apps you could do that as well. I think Recovery Record is one that I recommend my clients use. Two is plan. So like meal prepping, and you say you could do it in an hour, which I think that's, you're right. I think that's a huge barrier for some people. And then three is control your food environment.
Right. Yeah. Plan and have replacement foods ready.
Yeah.
And that plan isn't just about, you know, having the food, you know, the food ready to go right there with you. It also involves the, you know, the pre-craving phase, which, you know, you want to give yourself a power up at that point. Something to give you a little boost, something to get you ready to take on the, you know, the sugar demons. After that, you know, have your plan to, you know, I'm going to eat this healthy food. It's already ready to go. And, you know, like I said, if you have to do something and, you know, afterward, like go right to the gym or, you know, whatever it is to just get your mind away from that craving, do that. And then, you know, always control your food environment. And if you can do all of those things for about 10 days, that'll put you in what I call the promised land, where the cravings die down a lot. They become much quieter. You know, willpower is actually a thing you can use that works at this point because it's not a strong craving anymore. You can just be like, yeah, I've made it this far. I'm not going back. But it takes about 10 to 14 days to get into the promised land. If, you know, you basically what it takes is, you know, 100% compliance, no sugar, no processed foods for about 10 to 14 days. And then all of that stuff gets much easier. And once you're in the promised land, you're just coasting at that point. You just got to stay vigilant. Don't get too relaxed. Don't let those foods creep back into your diet and you're there. And let me say that I'm making it sound easy. It's not necessarily that easy. And some people's addictions are stronger than others, but this will work if you put it into practice, if you really adhere to it.
Okay. So let's talk a little bit about the struggles of using sugar as maybe an antidepressant. So right now we're recording this and it is during COVID-19 and individuals are socially isolated, which in your book, you talk a little about that. You say that you have to change your cage, but it's very difficult to do right now. And so I guess this is a two-part question. So how does social isolation affect our sugar addiction? And then also, why do individuals crave sugar and pasta and those types of things to sort of ease our mood, right? Make us feel better.
Right. So, you know, depression is one of those things that is going to put your sugar demons on steroids, unfortunately. Mm-hmm. Depression is a really, really tough thing to go through. You know, you don't have the mental energy to do a lot of things. So, you know, you've got to, and the sugar addiction isn't helping. It's actually feeding that depression even more. Mm-hmm. So it's tough. It is difficult. So if you are struggling with depression, you know, you definitely have to fight that at the same time. So you're just fighting two battles at this point, but the sugar is actually making it worse. And I'll tell you how. So Dr. Robert Lustig has a great book that just came out. It's his newest one. It's called, I believe, The Hacking of the American Mind. And it talks about addiction and how everything that is an addiction is really related to dopamine. And I actually had this explained to me a long time ago by a doctor who is an addiction specialist, mm-hmm. and is an alcoholic in recovery. Mm-hmm. And the way he described addiction to me was, he said, you know, basically, you know, every time you do something that your body interprets as beneficial to your survival, your brain releases dopamine. It's like a reward signal. That's what dopamine is. It basically tells you, hey, you did something good. So here's some dopamine. Here's like a good feeling. And so you eat a healthy meal, you know, you get about a 40% increase in dopamine in the brain, and it tells you, hey, you did something. You're going to survive the next day. You're going to be able to produce offspring. You know, it's an evolutionary mechanism, if you will, that keeps you alive. It's designed mm-hmm. to keep doing the things that are sustaining you. If you have a glass of wine, alcohol affects the brain by, you know, increasing dopamine by, I think, about 60% or something like that. It's probably different for everybody. You know, hugging a family member, you know, that increases dopamine and some other chemicals in the body like oxytocin. But those are all things that are beneficial to your survival, except for the alcohol. But if you're an alcoholic and you have a glass of wine, that might increase the dopamine, you know, a couple 100% because your brain is rewired, right, over time. And so, you know, cocaine is a 200% increase in dopamine across the board. I don't know what heroin is. I know that crystal meth is like a 600 to 800% increase in dopamine. So it's just a huge signal that tells you, like, you know, it's an artificial signal, you know, because crystal meth is not good for you, obviously. We all know that. It's one of the worst things for you. But your brain doesn't understand that. It just gets this signal and, you know, gives you this large dopamine increase that's going, hey, this is great for you. You know, you need to keep doing this. And over time, whether it's alcohol or crystal meth or food, those signals, they start to rewire your brain so that even though you consciously know that you're doing something that's bad for you, your brain is making that, whatever the bad thing is, more important than those other things that you need, like healthy food and the love of your family and, mm-hmm. you know, a job, things like that. And that's how addicts are made. And you know, it happens with food the same as it does with any other drug. So that's what you're fighting against here. And dopamine isn't really what you're after when it comes to happiness. Dopamine and happiness are two very different things, which is what Robert Lustig's book explores, The Hacking of the American Mind. That's what it explores, is that, you know, mm-hmm. dopamine we've made very cheap in this country. You know, you can get it on tap, essentially. You know, you can go get fast food for super cheap. You can watch whatever you want on the internet, you know, for, you know, the price of an internet connection. You can get dopamine a lot of ways, and it's very inexpensive and cheap in this country, but it's not the same thing as happiness. Mm-hmm. Happiness is related to something else. You know, it's a little more serotonin related. You know, having excess serotonin isn't necessarily the best thing for you either. It's a little more complicated than that, but dopamine comes at the cost of happiness, essentially. So pleasure, you're basically talking about dopamine is pleasure. Mm-hmm. Happiness is, you know, serotonin and some other chemicals, and they interfere with each other. So basically you can get pleasure easily in this country and cheaply, but it comes at the cost of happiness. So when you're just feeding your depression with more and more dopamine, right, you're actually going backwards. Mm-hmm. You're actually stopping yourself from getting better, from finding your way back to happiness. So you have to fight that. And that is really part of your struggle with addiction, or with depression, I should say, is, you know, you've got to get this addiction under control so you can also get the depression under control.
Right. Thank you for that. So as we sort of wrap up today, I thought maybe we could talk a little bit about what to do next, right? So what would you recommend that we do in light of this physical distancing and not being able to get to see our loved ones, or because addiction is the disease of isolation.
There's an author named Johan Hari. He wrote a book called Chasing the Scream. And he wrote that addiction isn't the opposite of sobriety. I think it's the addiction is the opposite of connection. Something like that. I can't remember. I'm probably misquoting him, but that's the, you know, that's kind of where you get that, is that, you know, without human connection, without connecting with people, that's when you kind of lead yourself down into that path of chasing the dopamine high, whether it's through drugs or food or, you know, online gambling, whatever it is that you're doing. So in this time when we are socially isolated, one, you're going to be at home a lot more. So you really need to make sure that you are going through the, you know, the first couple of steps, and, you know, your cravings are different on the weekends than they are, you know, when you have like a regular schedule, right? So now we're just on this long weekend.
It's a never-ending weekend.
Some of us, so your cravings are going to be different. So make sure you know where your cravings are coming from, the when and the where, so that you can at least, you know, have a plan to fight them. That's step one right there. Step two is I put at the, you know, that's getting to the promised land. So, you know, get to the promised land. Track your cravings, have your replacement foods ready, control your food environment, you know, have a plan. Get through the first 14 days if you can, and get to the promised land where the cravings die down so much that that's not the issue as much anymore. Now it's just about, you know, staying compliant. So, and then I have, you know, that's where, that's the majority of the book. That's like the first several chapters of my book is just getting to that point, because that's the hardest part. But then I switch over into the last chapter and I talk about where you said changing your cage. I go into this little acronym I invented. I think that's AIM, A-I-M, and it stands for, you know, activity, isolation, avoidance, and mindfulness. So the activity part is just, it's basically just a blueprint on how to live a little bit more of a focused life, I guess you could say, you know, something that, you know, make your life a little bit more enjoyable intentionally. So how do we do that? Well, with activity, you know, you should be doing something. You know, you shouldn't just be laying around watching as much YouTube as possible. I know that's hard to do with depression, but, you know, having some sort of activity for me, obviously it's exercise, you know, and that is, has been known to fight depression, to be very useful in a battle with depression. So, you know, do some sort of activity. It doesn't have to be intense exercise necessarily. Walking around your neighborhood is an activity. Gardening is an activity. You know, doing anything where you're just using your mind and your body together, you know, do something. Have plan your day out to where you have a little bit of that every day, something where you're actually moving. That's the number one, you know, that's the first part of AIM activity. Then the second part is isolation avoidance. Unfortunately, we're right in the middle of, you know, a thing where we kind of are forced to be isolated. Yeah. That doesn't mean, you know, you can't still connect with people. You know, you can still do it online, you know, but don't go into the necessarily social media where you're connecting, you know, and it's, there's like some sort of, you know, negative rhetoric or something going on. You're just picking up the phone and calling your grandparents, you know, make it a point to like verbally reach out to people over, you know, the phone is better. We don't really use the phone anymore. I know this because, you know, if I want to talk to my daughter, I have to basically do it through text now. So, you know, but actually picking up the phone and just checking on somebody. I actually made a list a few months ago when this started. I was like, you know what, I'm going to reach out via phone to just one person a day that I haven't talked to in forever. And just to be like, hey, I'm just calling to check on you. And, you know, I didn't manage to do it every day, but I tried to.
That's awesome.
That was very powerful because people were just like, oh yeah, hey man, thanks for checking, you know, thanks for checking on me. Thanks for seeing how things are. So, you know, that's something you can do to fight the isolation. You know, you'll feel better just for, you know, just calling out to someone, reaching out to somebody, anybody. You can have Zoom meetings with people, even though we're all sick of those, I'm sure, if you're, you know, having to do them for your job. But, you know, there's ways to reach out. And social media is probably the worst way to do it. So I would avoid that. But, you know, just reaching out via text or phone, preferably phone, as close as you can get to actually talking to another person one-on-one. That's going to be your best bet right now. So, you know, if you can't face-to-face meet with people, just go with the next best thing. And, you know, that's not Facebook. That's not Instagram. That's not Twitter. That is picking up a phone and calling them or setting up a Zoom with them or something. And then the mindfulness thing, that's another thing. I would schedule some of that every day too.
Yes.
Schedule some reaching out to one person a day if you can, and schedule a little bit of mindfulness. And, you know, in mindfulness, I give you guys several ways to do that. There are several free apps out there that you can, check on that you can use. I like the Headspace app, but that's a paid app, even though they do offer, I think, portion of it for free. Mm-hmm. So you can get started for free, but then you have to pay after a while. But there's other stuff out there. There's like breathe.com or zen.com and a few other things that are free, and plenty of things on the internet and YouTube that can teach you how to just sit quietly with your thoughts. And if you're not into that, cool, do some yoga. You can do, that can be activity and mindfulness together.
Yeah.
I've never been a big fan of yoga, but there's a few also, there's several apps out there that are free and some that are paid. I give both options in my book, but, plan some of that because, when you're doing any sort of mindfulness activity, you're really just taking care of your operating system. Your brain is your operating system, and you're working on that functioning properly. And, there's some stigma about all of these mental health issues that we have, whether it's addiction or, negative self-talk or, whatever it is that's wrong with your operating system. We're ashamed to talk about it, but it's the most important thing ever. Mm-hmm. And so, planning to take care of yourself, I consider that right up there with my, some sort of mindfulness practice is right up there with some sort of physical activity. They're both super important for your mental and physical well-being.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Well, that sounds like a good place to end. So, Jonathan, how can people best find you on the social and find your awesome book?
Sure. So my book is on Amazon. Mm-hmm. You can find it. It's titled The Sugar Demons, An Addict's Guide to Conquering Sugar Addiction. That's the only place it's sold, unfortunately, but it is you can get a paperback or an e-version of it. The ebook version is, I think it's priced as cheap as I could possibly price it at $2.99. Mm-hmm. So, and if you order the hard copy, it's $6.99, I believe. So that's the best place to find the book and the only place to find the book, to my knowledge. And the social media, I do have a Sugar Demons Facebook group where I just post articles and discussions. So you can look there. And it's just called Sugar Addiction Group, Killed the Sugar Demons. but I'm sure if you look or you search groups on Facebook, you'll find it. Put in Sugar Addiction. And then I'm on Instagram at Crandiva. At Crandiva. So my last name is Cranford. You can find me at Crandiva, C-R-A-N-D-I-V-A. And I believe that's the best places to find me on social media.
Yeah.
So I'm also on Twitter. It's just Jonathan Cranford.
Jonathan Cranford. Okay. Sounds good. All right, Jonathan. Well, thanks again for being on the show.
Yeah, thank you for having me.
Thank you for listening to the Atheists in Recovery podcast. For more great info and to stay up to date, head over to atheistsinrecovery.com.